Okay, so responding to my opponent claims, which stated that jobs that pay minimum wage were never meant to be a permanent job, I'd like to mention that many people do not have many job opportunities or options, so they have to work minimum wage jobs. So some of those people are people that have committed felonies, so their criminal records don't allow them to get better paid jobs. And in some cases, they don't have legal documents to get better jobs in this country, so they have to take whatever they can. They also have few opportunities for training or advancement. Therefore, they are locked into these low-wage jobs. Also, mobility will not bring significant advancement to most low-wage workers. According to the Economic Policy Institute, even after a 25-year period, half of those in the lowest 20% of wage earners had not moved above the group, and of those that moved half had only moved to the next highest wage group, still below the median wage. We might also think that low-wage jobs are often related to teenagers or uneducated people. However, according to the Center for Economic and Policy Research, most workers in low-wage jobs aren't adults. Teenagers comprise only 7% of the workforce. So the population who benefit from a minimum wage increases on average 35 years old. It's 88% over the age of 20. And in 2011, 3.8 million American workers, most of whom were out of their teens, earned the federal minimum wage of $7.25 per hour, or less, according to the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics. Also, responding to my opponent's claims, of which is stated that inflation will eventually lead to job losses or raise credit price, I'll mention that inflation is not necessarily linked to wage increases. The more money people make, the more money they can spend. So most of low-wage workers will immediately spend their increased income by buying goods and services to meet their family's basic needs. They will purchase those goods and services from local businesses and stimulate our local economy and eventually our nation economy. A 2013 study by the Chicago Fed found that increasing the minimum wage, even just to $9 an hour, would increase consumer spending by $28 billion. When spending demand increases, manufacturers of goods and services can actually charge less or at least avoid increasing their prices because they're increasing overall revenue. So writing for the Department of Labor, a small business owner, Gina Schaffer, explained it as such: nearly all of my employees earn $10 or more per hour, and here's what I know. Providing higher than minimum wages sends a message that we value our employees. We value them as assets to their business because we know they are the people who are on the front lines with our customers. Higher wages led to happier employees who stay with me longer and reduce my turnover and training costs. It's more expensive to hire and train new workers than it is to retain a long-term loyal workforce. Workers win because they have more purchasing power, and employers win because they're more able to rely on a happy, productive workforce. In addition to this, as an increase to minimum wage moves families above the poverty line, their need for public assistance decreases. Even though some people will still use it, it will allow workers to survive on their own income. According to a study conducted by CNN, raising the minimum wage to $10.10 will leave more than 5 million Americans out of poverty and help 14 million children see a boost in their family income. 14 million women, including 6 million working mothers, will get a raise, and 3 million single parents would be better able to sustain their families. David Cooper, an economic analyst with the Economic Policy Institute, mentions that raising the minimum wage to $10.10 will reduce government expenditures on current income support programs by $7.6 million per year, and possibly more. So the use of this money could be sent to other programs like education or infrastructure instead of being used in welfare or food stamps programs.